We've got a few folks filing in still, but I think we should go ahead and get started. It is 1 o'clock. I'm Patrick Bellman. I'm Department Head of Watershed Sciences. You know, if you look around and you're paying attention, we're at a really challenging time in human history. We're experiencing a number of converging crises, ecological crises, social crises, political crises at local scales up to global scales. And a lot of those are stemming from the interface between economics and sustainability. Climate change is accelerating, as are many of our impacts on the biosphere, the Arctic, the Antarctic, right here in Utah, Great Salt Lake, Utah Lake. It's a long, long list. And you pile on top of that an intensifying epistemic crisis where many of us don't know what to believe. We live in this blizzard of information and misinformation and disinformation, and it's been harder than ever to sort through that, and with some of the changes in AI technology, that is looking even harder in the future. Some people have suggested we live in a post-truth era. I don't think that's true. I think we live in an age of consequences because of the magnitude of things that we can do, and we need to make sure that we're bringing reason and courage to a lot of these decisions that we have to make to make sure we get it right. As a species, humans are really capable of extraordinary feats. Many of you are probably aware that we just sent a rocket up into space, rendezvoused with an asteroid about the size of a skyscraper, landed it on the asteroid in the middle of space, collected a sample, and then flew it back here to Utah, in fact. It landed in Utah. The technology, the coordination, the math, the ambition and confidence that it takes to do things like that is amazing. And it's only possible because of the economic system that we have in place right now, right? And of course, it took like a month to open up the sample container, but that's beside the point. We got it open and we're doing science with it. But we're also capable of immense destruction. You know, we are dismantling entire mountains, we are destroying entire forests, destroying habitat and causing extinction of species at an unprecedented rate. Humans now move more dirt around the planet than all natural processes combined. And we are the dominant mover of stuff on the surface of the Earth. So with all this potential for good and destruction, how do we ensure that we are moving someplace better, that we're improving quality of life, improving prosperity for people and the planet? And we're not moving towards a future more like, say, the Hunger Games. That's not where we want to end up. We have to be deliberate about how we're moving forward. And that's why we're here. We're here to have those hard, thoughtful, and honest conversations about how and why the world is changing. We have one planet to manage, and so we really need to be getting on the same page about how to manage it. One thing that seems to unite most people is that economic growth is a good thing. It doesn't matter if you're watching Fox News or CNN or MSNBC or whatever. Growth is always talked about as being a good thing because it lifts standards of living, it pays for environmental remediation, does a lot of other good things we'll hear more about today. But there's a growing chorus of voices that's questioning that wisdom, that economic growth is the way out of these polycrises that we're experiencing. And so that's why we've organized these dialogues, these set of conversations where we can come back and express differences of opinion and get to a better place and hopefully a more coherent sense of where we need to head. The idea is to examine the claim that growth can help us navigate this polycrisis that we're in, why that's been the model for nearly a century now, and if or how that growth model needs to change. So we've brought together a great group of experts who've been really thinking deeply for a long time about these issues. And most importantly, we're really thrilled that you're here to be part of the conversation. We've got a number of active ways for you to be engaged in this. I'll talk more about those in a second, but I'll hand it off to Frank Caliendo for now.
Thank you, Patrick. My name is Frank Caliendo, and I serve as the Associate Dean in the Huntsman School of Business, and I'm a co-organizer of this conference along with Patrick. Throughout these sessions, you'll hear from scholars from different backgrounds. That's an intentional feature of this symposium. You'll hear from economists, business leaders, physical scientists, earth scientists, political scientists, and more. These experts will have different viewpoints. I hope we can learn from each other. We may disagree on some issues, and that's okay. I believe we can deal with competing ideas in a thoughtful way. Professor Belmont has been the driving force behind this exciting symposium. He has my deepest respect as a fair-minded, thoughtful scholar, and I appreciate that he's gone out of his way to invite experts from business and economics. These fields have a perspective that adds to, not detracts from, but adds to our ability to tackle tough environmental problems. As a student of the way the world works, I have observed that economic forces are swift and powerful. I believe solutions to environmental problems will be more durable if they are grounded in economic principles. For instance, economists tend to believe that markets work. We spend our careers studying them. Why would we do that? Well, under certain conditions, markets are an efficient way to organize economic activity. In fact, markets, as you know, are the very foundation of the American economy and have helped to take us from basically nothing to the economic leader of the modern world, all in just a few hundred years. However, sometimes markets fail. So while economists admire markets, we're also careful to recognize their limits and the potential role for responsible economic policy. Markets can fail for different reasons. One would be if buyers and sellers have different information. Another would be if a producer does not bear the full costs of its production activities. But we have to be careful here too. Governments can also fail. Government solutions may or may not improve upon market outcomes. So we have to be very thoughtful and critical in our analysis. Our speakers over the next 3 weeks are going to take us deep into these exciting topics. I look forward to learning many new things, and thank you so much for attending, and please enjoy.
Thank you, Frank. I'll just really briefly run through the schedule so you all know what is coming ahead. We've got a couple words from Jeannie Johnson here from the Center for Anticipatory Intelligence on maintaining an open mind. We're going to talk about some hard things here, and there may be some things that run contrary to what you currently believe. That's the whole point of being here and having these hard conversations. Brian Steed and David Zook will provide some really great local examples, tangible examples of how economic growth and sustainability have been clashing a bit right here at home in Utah. We'll have a short break. There'll be some snacks and things out in the lobby that you can eat. And then we'll start promptly again at 2:05 for our two keynotes by Craig Paulson and Rob Davies. And you'll notice that those two talk titles are fairly different. Economic growth must continue or we can't. And economic growth will end soon. Done well, this will be a good thing. This is what we're here for. This is what's exciting about bringing this group of experts together. We can have these differences of opinion and do it in a constructive way. And then we'll have a short panel discussion at the end. But a big part of this series is having these conversations and then letting things percolate for a little bit. And so we'll come back next week and we'll reflect on some of the differences in perspective and opinion that we heard here and work through some of those. And then we'll have a couple of case studies next week. We'll come back the following week and hear a bit more from some experts about how economic growth and sustainability are likely to co-evolve in the future and have some panel discussions, again, wrapping up a lot of the conversation that we've had here. There are lots of ways for you to be involved. There were some banners out in the lobby. If you saw those, we'd love to get your thoughts on some of those things about economic growth and sustainability. You should have received one of these cards, or there's a couple that are out on the end of these railings here. These are places where you could write down questions. If you want to write down a question for the panel, we'll try to address it today, or if you don't have enough time, it'll be used to address some of the things that we do next week. Or you can scan that QR code, and that will take you to a poll where you can enter a question there. And so we'll get to as many of those as we can. When I pitched this idea to USUSA President Abe Rodriguez, he said, okay, I love this idea, but you have to make it fun. And so this is part of the fun. This is my idea of fun. And we'll also be entering these into a raffle. So we'll have a couple of prizes that we'll hand out. We also have Jacob over in the corner here storyboarding for us. So he'll present kind of a visual of what he is seeing here. And I'm excited to see what that comes out to. So without any further ado, I'll turn it over to Jeannie.
Hi, everyone. It is so good of you to carve out 2.5 hours from your Friday, no less, to come and be part of Dialogues. And to let you know that we're serious about the actual talking part of Dialogues, get ready to be slightly uncomfortable because you are going to do some talking in the next 10 minutes. So if you have an inner extrovert, see where that is and get ready to channel it. That will happen in just a few minutes. I'm the director for the Center for Anticipatory Intelligence. And what we do on campus is bring together an amazing community of students from all 8 colleges and then tackle some of the most difficult problems that we collectively face, doing so from perspectives from all 8 colleges. So we have learned some really powerful, valuable lessons in that process. We talk about climate change, we talk about economic growth and sustainability, we talk about how artificial intelligence might impact this landscape, or why, when people are presented with what seem to be really sensible solutions, they choose to ignore them and go on doing maybe what they have traditionally been doing. So we investigate all of those sorts of topics, and we also engage in facilitation training. Because the problems that we face collectively are complex by nature, they are multi-sided. They involve diverse and sometimes contending stakeholders. Then the group that aims to solve or even make progress on those problems also has to be complex, has to be multi-sided, has to involve stakeholders, maybe even contending stakeholders from diverse groups. This is not easy to pull off. And the truth is, our entire higher education system a little bit works against us. We are very hyper-siloed into our majors. We are business students, or engineering students, or political science students, or English students. And we don't have a whole lot of opportunities to get together and really meld our brains in an effort to solve common problems. So this Friday session and the Friday sessions that will happen in the next 2 weeks are an attempt toward that, getting a diverse group of people together. Now, marvelous and diverse as you are, this will have limited utility if you don't talk to each other, right? So we in this room need to also form connections with each other. So we're going to do this through a brief exercise. One of the things we have learned through our program is that an inhibitor to creative problem solving is something called anchoring bias. And many of you may have run into this in some of your other courses, but our anchoring biases are the notions, the really firm determinations, maybe deep-seated beliefs that we bring with us to a problem set. So I'm going to ask you to identify your own anchoring bias that you brought with you in 3 different categories, and then you're going to chit-chat with someone, and you can choose which anchoring bias you want to share, but kind of talk through those. It's really important to identify them and maybe even write them down. So get out your phones, or if you brought a notepad with you, get out your notepad. Because for those of you who are willing to hang with us through all 3 weeks, it will be interesting to see where you have maybe expanded your cognitive horizon a little bit beyond those anchoring biases from having listened to stakeholders who may be new to you, perspectives that perhaps you hadn't considered. And so we're looking for individually that kind of cognitive growth and aiming toward kind of our two primary mandates as a center, being problem solvers and bridge builders, because you can't really be one without the other. If you're going to solve the truly important problems of our time, you have to be a bridge builder. You have to be able to reach out to diverse stakeholders. All right, so here's your first category for anchoring bias. And this is one that may feel a little sensitive even to admit to yourself. But for you, before you walked into this room, when you were thinking about this topic, the topic that explores both eco-sustainability and business and growth, who is the other for you? Who is the group that is your other? So think about that for a minute. Write it down somewhere. I am super stubborn and super patient, so I will wait for you to write it down. So write it down, record it in your phone, and then just to yourself, you don't have to share all of these, but I want you to just stream of consciousness, pour out any of the labels, the notions, kind of the cognitive fixtures in your mind that have to do with that other. So I'm going to give you just a minute to write it down. What are some of the labels? What are some of your beliefs about that other? Some of you are even using pens. That just does something wonderful to my heart. I don't know why, right? A little bit of analog in the room. Okay, the next one is the flip side of that. What is the lens you have about yourself? What's the group that you sort of self-assign to? What labels go with that group? What are some preferred solutions that go with your group? Things that you're pretty attached to, that you think if people were good people, they would do this thing. If they were right-headed, they would do this thing. So be self-reflective. What are some labels and anchoring biases you have about yourself? Now, not everyone in this room is Gen Z, but I'm going to speak kind of directly to those who are Gen Z, because I think there's often an underappreciation of how difficult the environment has been that you have grown up in. You have grown up under a really heavy cloud of narratives having to do with the earth and its longevity, maybe the national debt, politics that is more polarized than most of us have seen in our lifetimes, and the pandemic, you know, just to top it off. This is you're a tough generation. And by showing up to a conference that aims at a degree of hope and solution building, that shows that you have a lot of grit and that you haven't entirely lost your sense of hope and your sense of forward progress. But the last anchoring bias to write down is your picture of the future. What's the picture of the future that you now hold? What do you really think happens next? In the next 5 years, the next 10 years, what's your picture of the future? All right. Now comes the bridge building part. If we're gonna be serious about this, it requires being uncomfortable. So I know you're sitting next to the person you know, right? That's what we do. So try to talk to someone either behind you or in front of you or diagonally from you. If you need to do that as a foursome because there's only one person behind you, you can. But share at least one of the biases that you're willing to share, because here's the really important principle we're going to pursue. You can hear what people on this panel have to say and walk away unchanged. hearing doesn't really do us a lot of good unless we choose to engage instead in listening. And as a mentor of mine often says, listening is hearing someone else out with a willingness to change your mind. That's a very different activity. So that's where we want to start in identifying our own biases, is by sort of setting them up and being willing to think past them a little bit. So introduce yourself. You have all of 1 minute to do this. Introduce yourself and just tell someone behind you or in front of you your bias. So the whole room should be full of noise for the next minute. I am wildly impressed. Thank you for that level of conversation. And I know that you haven't had nearly enough time. So I'd like to invite you to continue that conversation at our break. And I'm going to turn the time over to my very good friend and colleague, Brian Steed.
And I think I'm mic'd. Can you guys hear me okay? Awesome. My name is Brian Steed. I am so excited to be here with you all today. I have to say, it's a little weird. And when Jeannie was up talking about these different ideas of, you know, how I would self-identify, I don't know. And I was just talking to Patrick on the side. It's something interesting because when Patrick pitched this conference, I kind of had this vision from the movie Braveheart, where two warring sides with faces painted meet somewhere in the middle of the quad and duke this out. It's my hope that we can have a more productive conversation than that. I'm here to talk about the Great Salt Lake. I have two hats. I'm the executive director of the Janet Quinney Lawson Institute for Land, Water, and Air here at Utah State. But I'm also the commissioner of the Great Salt Lake. And as the graphic played, as we started here, you might notice something different about the Great Salt Lake if you've been a Utah native for some time or just being paying attention. The Great Salt Lake's changed, and it's changed pretty substantially, so much so that I can say in my life we've hit both the highs of when we've seen the recorded highs of the Great Salt Lake and seen the recorded lows of the Great Salt Lake. And right now, despite a really great winter last year, we're sitting near the lows. Two other things to point out on this graphic on the Great Salt Lake is that humans have already directly impacted the lake. That's without question. You can actually see a dividing line across the middle. That's the Union Pacific Causeway. That's the Union Pacific Causeway that was built in the 1950s. It wasn't intended to be a dividing line between the lake, but in fact, it sunk over time. It's acted much more like a reservoir on the north arm, kept water, fresh water from flowing into that side of the lake, and so that side has become hypersaline. Hypersalinity means that really the ecological productivity of that part of the lake is very limited, meaning that in fact, we have only a couple of things that really live there well, a couple types of what they call halophiles, salt-loving critters, and occasionally they'll turn that lake, that side of the lake, bright pink. The south arm is really where we have the ecological vitality of the lake and where we see things like brine shrimp and brine flies that we're going to talk about in just a second. The second thing I'll point out on this is that notice the economic activity around the lake. And I think, yeah, I do. See this right here? So right here, that's Willard Bay, by the way. Willard Bay. This right here is Compass Minerals. This right here is U.S. Magnesium. If any of you have a saltwater, a water softener in your house, and you get crystals that are, there's a variety of different types, probably manufactured right here just so you know. And so there's a lot of different things that we have on the Great Salt Lake. Lots of human impact. Let's talk about the elevations. Since we started taking account, we really have great data from when humans started to measure back in 1847. Before that, there was variability, and Darren Perry can talk about those elevations well before 1847 and how important the lake was to his people. The reality is, in the contemporary period, that we changed the ecosystem when we got here. We diverted a lot of water, and we've seen a relative stasis around what we're calling around 4200, maybe 4199, in that period between 1900 and the present date. You'll also notice that dividing line there where you have two sides of the lake, where you have the dark blue being the south arm, the light blue being the north arm, and they're not always tracking at the same levels, and that's something that's interesting. Something interesting as well to note that we had the largest winter in recorded history last winter. We did not have the largest runoff, and in fact, we did not get as much water in the lake as we hoped. Even with a series of designs to keep salinity levels more controlled in the south arm only rose about 5.5 feet. After this huge winter, the north arm, as you might notice, didn't raise hardly at all. And so that's something that we're tracking pretty closely. Let's talk about economic demands. Great Salt Lake Watershed sits over where the majority of people in Utah live. That becomes important to know because not only do people like to live here, but they also require water to live here. And because they require water to live here, much of our stability and our security here in this area has been by diverting that water and using it for things that we like. And that's meant sometimes to the detriment of the Great Salt Lake. The other thing just to note, to be aware of, that if we're talking about where people do live now, where they might live if we continue to grow in the same way we're going, it's all those same areas with the exception of Washington County. So we expect to see much larger growth in those areas from the population projections. So the question is, who uses the water? Well, we do. In large measure. Agriculture being the largest user, that shouldn't be a surprise to anyone. We developed agricultural systems over the times, and we had, in fact, first in time, first in right as our controlling, guiding policy for water. Second largest user would be municipal and industrial. And so when you look at that, we're using a lot of water. And that water is great for economic purposes. If you look at, say, agriculture, the study done by Utah State Extension just last year found that agriculture in the Great Salt Lake Basin is probably valued around $2 billion per year. It's a lot. If you look at mineral production off the Great Salt Lake, it also turns out to be another about $2 billion off of the Great Salt Lake. And so there are direct things that we use this water for. In addition to that, the water security that allows all of us to live here comfortably without fear of having, you know, turning on the tap and not having water flowing. That's something that's harder to quantify, but it's many billions of dollars worth of value. But keep in mind that also has its trade-offs. As we then collect water, that's water that's not receiving to the, or not going into the Great Salt Lake. So this is a graph from last year that shows that last year we stopped about 1.6 million acre feet. An acre foot is, you know, an acre, a foot deep in water. So about the size of a football field, a foot deep in water. 1.6 million of those captured in our reservoirs, which is awesome for those of us who like to drink, which is all of us. But it is scary from the Great Salt Lake's perspective because a lot of the water that we hoped to get to the Great Salt Lake didn't get there. So another economic factor, what do all these things have in common? All these things are produced by the Great Salt Lake. And you're probably not aware of that. Fruits and nuts. Sulfate of potash, prime fertilizer on California fruits and nuts, shrimp, brine shrimp. No, those are not brine shrimp. They're Taylor shrimp, but if it's farmed, generally speaking, they've been farmed with eggs. 40% of aquaculture, where people are feeding shrimp or whatever, comes from stuff found in the Great Salt Lake brine shrimp. The F-35, we have titanium, magnesium, both found in Great Salt Lake. Cell phone, lithium, found in the Great Salt Lake. And then the soda cans, just be aware that magnesium is a big part of that hardening of the soda cans itself. which allows you to not crush them when you drink them. Interestingly, where is the only produced magnesium in the Western United, or the Western Hemisphere? Turns out it's the Great Salt Lake, which is interesting. Putting that all aside, though, there's huge ecological demands on the Great Salt Lake. It's a huge, unique, and vital ecosystem. Those are all brine flies being consumed by our state bird, the California seagull. And there is something truly unique about the Great Salt Lake. Eighth largest saline lake in the world, the largest in the Western Hemisphere, and increasingly important to at least 12 million birds that stop through every year to do just this, refuel. So we have at least three species that we know of that are extraordinarily dependent on this ecosystem. And if that ecosystem were to go away, generally speaking, we would have cause to doubt the future survival of these species. So the ecologic impacts of a drying lake, we know that that might have huge consequences to the ecosystem. In addition to that, there are things that impact both the ecology as well as us. If we have a drying lake, we have less lake effect. Less lake effect means we will lose 5, maybe even 10% of lake effect snow. That's 5 to 10% of snowpack it's 5 to 10% of snowpack along the Wasatch Front through lake effect snow. Consider that if you're guaranteed as a water manager to have 5% less water, that's scary for a lot of people. And then we have a whole bunch of other economic activities that rely on that. Also, dust and snow don't mix very well. When you have dust coming off that dried lake bed, snow melts much faster. In fact, a study last year found that snow at Alta Ski Resort melted 2 full weeks early, which means they had 2 weeks less of economic activity in Alta. And then dust and health effects, we don't do well in a dusty environment. In fact, it gets in our lungs, it causes all sorts of health effects, and when that happens, we generally have to mitigate for the dust. Just the cost of hardening infrastructure to make sure we don't have dust problems is at least $1.5 billion in economic costs, plus an additional $15 million per year. So that's a problem. So we have this trade-off. We have this lake that's important, we know it's important, but we also have needs for water. We have needs for water for a growing population that we can't live without, so what can we do? And this is, I think, why these types of conferences are really important, because here's the thing. People can make choices. People can make choices and do things differently, and if we make the right choices, we actually can have more sustainable and more sustained growth. Conservation of the Great Salt Lake is going to be something that we're going to be preaching for the next forever. The way you use water impacts how much water gets to the lake, and how much water gets to the lake will impact your welfare here. And so when you look at how much water it takes, we're really talking, at an average year, an additional 471,000 acre feet per year getting to the Great Salt Lake. It's a lot of water. So that's going to require a fair amount of effort on our part. How are we going to do that? Well, we really have to focus on how we grow. We have choices on how we use water in a municipal and an industrial setting. And if we choose to grow more water neutral, we actually have more water to use. If we choose to grow the way we have grown, with big lots and uncontrolled use, chances are we will have less stable and less predictability in our water future. Similarly in agriculture, we need to become more efficient in how we use water in agriculture. We've shown through studies here at Utah State University, guys like Matt Yost and Burdette Barker, that you're able to actually reduce the amount of water used in agriculture through different technological means. They have found through those means you can actually have as much as 15% reduction in water diversions. That's a big deal. And if we're able to apply that basin-wide, that actually does provide a lot of water as well. And then we have to focus on making sure that the water gets from where it is currently being used to where we conserve it, and then we make sure that that conserved water gets to where it needs to be. In my role, I'll be a strong advocate saying that where it needs to be is we need to have more water in the Great Salt Lake because we're a long ways away from healthy levels. But that's something that we all, as citizens of Utah, will get to decide in the next little bit. And those choices will matter. And so being informed on how we make decisions on water uses, as well as informed on the policy choices we make as society, will make a big difference. So with that, I'm happy to take any questions later. I'll be here all afternoon. but happy to answer any questions on how your actions matter and how we grow matters. Thanks so much.
That was fascinating, Brian. Thanks for sharing that. My name is David Zook, and as I was listening to Frank talk about all the experts that were going to be here today, the scientists and the scholars, and I was waiting for him to say my category, and then at the end he said, and more. So I'm the and more, and I'm a local elected official, and I'm with Cache County, and I was asked to talk about a little bit of our local economy, our local growth, and some of the things that we have going on here in our community that are affecting our environment, and I'm excited to talk to you about some of those. It was cool to see how many friends and neighbors are in the audience today, and I hope you enjoy some of these local perspectives. So I wanted to talk about our economy first, and this has always impressed me about Cache Valley. Cache Valley has such a strong economy, and where we're all at right now, Utah State University is the reason why. Utah State University is our economic engine, really. There is so much that gets cranked out of this university that stimulates our economy, from the smart people who get educated here to the ideas that get developed here. So many of those turn into entrepreneurial activities, local businesses who take that information, that knowledge, and put it into practice. And that makes our economy really diverse. And that creates a lot of jobs. And that makes us have a great community to live in, where people can live and work and raise a family and have the money to do that. Our unemployment rate, 2.2%, is what it was last time I looked, and that's really low. A couple of years ago, about 2 years ago, we got down to 1.0% even for our unemployment rate. And back when I was in school, I was taught that 5% was considered full employment, and that was kind of a goal that everybody shot for. And to get down as low as 1.0% or 2.2% is kind of an interesting thing, because that makes it actually a little difficult for the economy to grow, because there's a shortage of workers for our companies to hire so they can grow. So we have something in our economy also that I think is really interesting. We have a very diverse economy with so many different types of industries here. Of course, agriculture, as Brian just talked about, is one of our foundations, but we have so much now with the university being here on the high-tech side, and that really makes our economy strong. That diversity makes us better able to weather changes that might come our way. So one of the things that really drives economies around the world and here in Cache Valley even is population. And our population has been growing pretty rapidly here in Cache County. If you looked at our population back in the 2010 census, we're about 113,000 people. And then by the 2020 census, we were at 133,000. So we added 20,000 people in that time period. And this is what our estimate is already. So we've already, based on estimates, added another 15,000. That's almost how many we added in the whole last decade. So we're growing pretty rapidly. And there are a lot of factors that play into that. And one of the biggest factors that we have that's driving our growth here is our own kids. And if you look at that 20,000 people that we added in the last census, the 20,000 people added to the population of Cache County, 17,000 of them were kids. 17,000 was internal growth. So if you look at how much, that's called natural increase, if you look at how much natural increase we had in our county, only San Pete County has a higher rate of natural increase. It's about 85% of our growth historically has been from natural increase, from our own kids. And people in Utah tend to have bigger families, more kids. Those dynamics have been changing a little bit. How many kids people are having, when they decide to have kids, those are probably going to influence our future growth and how quickly we grow and how much we grow. A few years ago, we had the highest birth rate of any state. We've dropped, I think we're fourth now. So that's changed just in the last couple of years. And we were, if you look at the census numbers from the last census, we were the fastest growing state. Utah was the fastest growing state in the nation. And Cache County is a big part of that. So this growth and the kids, that creates challenges for us. That creates challenges in our community. And this slide, this is my call to action. Usually people have the call to action at the end. I stuck it kind of in the middle because I want to make sure you're still paying attention. And I want everyone to think about this one, because the way that we're going to deal with the growth that we have, the way that we're going to deal with changes in our economy, the way that we're going to deal with the traffic that comes with that growth, the environmental impacts that come with that growth, is through planning. And we need to think about how we're going to deal with those things. We need to think about what strategies we're going to implement and how we're going to mitigate the potential negative effects of that growth. And the way we do that is so often through various planning organizations that we have in our community. We have a couple of planning organizations related to transportation, the Cache Metropolitan Planning Organization, and we have the Cache County Council of Governments. They deal with a lot of transportation funding and transportation planning, and we're working on a number of trails projects and active transportation planning projects. We have our Bear River Association of Governments that works on a lot of economic development, social-related programs, planning for the region across northern Utah. Our cities are all involved with planning. They all have planning commissions. So there are so many opportunities for you to get involved in that planning. And over these dialogues, over the next few weeks, you're going to be hearing about a lot of things that are happening in Cache County, in Utah, across our nation, across the world. And you might be thinking, what can be done? How can we make a difference? What can I do? What you can do is you can do something right here in your community. And I encourage you to find a way that you can get involved. All of these agencies have planning efforts that are happening. There's one going on right now through the Bear River Health Department that is called Communities That Care. And it's about the planning process is about how we can make this a better community for our youth in the future, how we can make this a safe place, a healthy place for kids. Really cool planning effort that's happening across our communities right now. We have one group in the north, one in the middle of the valley in Logan, and one in the south. And good people with good ideas trying to make this a better place for the future. I think there are a lot of people in this room who think that way. I'd love to have you involved in these efforts. So speaking of planning, one of the things that we need to plan for is housing. I talked about our population growth and how we're adding all these new people, and where are they all gonna live? How many of you have tried to buy a house or find a place to rent in the last couple of years? If you have, you've noticed it's challenging. We have some serious challenges. I looked last month. I haven't looked at the numbers in the last couple of weeks, but I looked last month, and within the past 30 days before that, the average home price that was sold here in Cache Valley was over $500,000. And even if you went in with a 20% down payment, which is $100,000, over $100,000 probably, your income that you have to have to be able to afford that mortgage is over $100,000 a year in income to be able to buy the average house that's being sold right now in Cache Valley. That doesn't seem sustainable. That doesn't seem economically feasible for students graduating from Utah State University or for many people in our county. Our wages here in Cache County have historically been about $1,000 a month less than the state average. So our wages are traditionally lower. Even though we have this really strong economy here, we tend to have lower wages here. But housing isn't cheaper here. Housing is still really expensive. The cost of living here is still quite expensive. So we have some major challenges with supply that are driving our shortages, that are driving costs up, and we need to do something about that. And so Jeannie with the Center for Anticipatory Intelligence was talking to me before we got started today, and she was telling me that one of the things that she's trying to do in her program is to get people to come together to talk about solutions and to get people to work together. And that's something that I'm really proud of our community and something they did when it comes to housing. So a couple of years ago, we had a housing crisis task force that was put together. And this task force included about 50 people with a whole variety of backgrounds and experiences and knowledge. And these 50 people came together and they looked at our housing crisis and they looked at solutions. And they looked at what we could do to make things better for our housing crisis. And they came up with a report that they put out with a variety of suggestions. And we've been spending the last year or so working to implement those suggestions. And some of those suggestions are policy suggestions at the local, state, and even federal level. And a big piece of it, though, was public education, because the task force felt like one of the primary factors that was affecting availability and then cost of housing was public sentiment, and especially public sentiment and how it influences local elected officials and their housing policies. So we were able to get a grant from the state and put together some public outreach activities, and we made some videos. We've been getting those out. I'd like to show you one of those videos real quick.
Cache County, for example, expected to grow about 66% in the next 30 years. Where do you think most of that's coming from?
California.
We're here at the Cache County Fair, talking to fairgoers about the housing crisis, asking people what they know, what they think, and what they think might fix it.
The interest is so high, people can't afford houses.
People are having a challenge trying to find places to live.
I feel like we have a lot of people coming in, but not a lot of space for everybody.
I think if we build a lot more houses here, we're gonna have a lot of problems.
And so there's definitely a big influx of people just because it's such a gorgeous place to live.
Probably coming a lot more from out of state.
Yeah, stop giving them so many building permits. It's overcrowded.
One of the things I often hear is people think that our housing crisis is caused by outsiders coming into our valley. If you look at the data, 85% of our growth is our own children. Our own kids and grandkids are who are driving most of our growth.
We have an amazing economic atmosphere here in the state of Utah, but also we value families. We have large families, and that's something that we hold dear. And so through the misconception that these people are coming from outside, it's our own talents, our talented children and their grandchildren that want to stay and take advantage of these jobs and this economic entrepreneurial atmosphere that we have in Utah. And it's our own growth that's fueling this.
Really, it's our residents and citizens who help lead the charge on these issues. As more and more people have become aware and actually are affected by this housing crisis, there's been more and more collaboration and coordination between governments, developers, and residents about the best ways to address these issues.
This is not about keeping outsiders out of Cache Valley. This is about keeping our children in Cache Valley.
When I talk to businesses, they really need places for their employees to live.
Sustainment is met at about a quarter acre lot. Hyde Park City's been built on half acre lots. It's just not sustainable.
Density's fine, it doesn't hurt, but planning it in the right way is the important aspect. Then, and creating some good competition amongst renters, maybe we can get the affordability to come down a little bit.
You get mixed emotions because you want it the same way that it used to be, but you realize, you know, when you have your kids and your grandkids grow up, you'd also like them pretty close to you.
Last thing I'm going to talk about today is open space. One of the things I really love about Cache Valley is how beautiful it is. It's a gorgeous place. We have incredible mountains, waterways, wildlife, and the farms that are gorgeous. And we all want to preserve that. We want this community to be beautiful in the future like it is today. And I used to work with the mayor of Nibley. He says, we all want it to stay exactly how it was right after we changed it. And I think that's kind of funny because that's how I felt when I moved here. I thought, okay, let's put up a gate on the canyon. No one else gets to come in. Let's preserve it and keep it exactly how it is now. But that's challenging. So we put together a group of people a few years ago, actually, and we started talking about this issue of open space preservation. And it actually came out of a discussion we were having about trails, and then we started talking about open space. And we had tried a few years ago to put this on the ballot, and the voters rejected it. Didn't vote for it. So we decided to try it again. And what we did is we followed that same pattern. We put together a coalition of various stakeholders. We had the agricultural community there. We had the outdoorsmen there. We had the nature lovers there. We had a broad cross-section of people who all love the open space in Cache Valley. And we started working together to figure out how we could get support for this bond on the ballot. So just over a year ago, we put it on the ballot, and it passed. And we were so happy, we were so excited, because it had been tried before and it failed, and this time it worked. This time the people of Cache County decided that they wanted to do something about open space. So we have $20 million that was approved by the voters to help us preserve open space. Of course, we're hoping to leverage that with federal, state, private funds, and to turn that into much more than $20 million in value. But the process is just getting underway now. This month, probably, the application process will open up and people will be able to voluntarily participate in this and submit an application to preserve land that they own. In most cases, they'll continue using it. They'll continue farming it. It'll be something that they'll continue to own in many cases. But what we're looking for is we're looking for land that can meet all of the criteria that we're looking for, land that provides space for wildlife, land that preserves waterways, land that preserves viewsheds, land that preserves agriculture. And the most competitive applications will be the ones that check the most of those boxes. So we are really excited about this, and we just issued the first $6 million of bonds, and they're going to be available probably starting this month. So I just wanted to say, lastly, your local governments, they work for you. So if you have ideas, if you have concerns, reach out to us. Here's my contact information. If there are things that we should be doing, talk to your local leaders. Let us know what your ideas are. Get involved. My call to action earlier, I hope you remember that. I hope you find a way that you can serve and you can make our community better. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jeannie and Brian and David. Some great relevant examples to give us some local hooks for how important these decisions are. We've got a lot of decisions to make, and they end up building in quality of life for decades. So we want to make sure we're making those right decisions. We're going to take a brief break now. We'll come back at exactly 2:05. We'll get started again, but you can get your blood sugar up outside in the lobby. There's some sweets and whatnot in there. And yeah, feel free to fill in those cards with questions you have. Go to the poll with the QR code in the back, and you can put your questions in that way. And we'll start again shortly for our two keynote talks.
Am I live? I'm live. It's the summer between my freshman and sophomore year. I'm sitting down to watch a movie, and I don't realize yet that I'm about to have a canon event. I am thinking about what I want to major in, maybe like some of you here in this audience. I fell in love with economics when I was in high school. It was so interesting to me. Things made sense. And then as I considered what my future would be, I wasn't quite sure what I could do with economics. Now, I was stupid back then and didn't realize that there are just so many opportunities for people who study economics. But this is my main fear as I'm trying to decide about my future. And as I had decided instead to major in computer science. I had a knack and a history for programming, and I decided, why not use that? And I could get some great career skills out of my college education. But I'm in this movie, and that thought is still tormenting me. What do I want to major in? Am I sure that this is the path that I'm going to take? And during the course of this movie, I have a realization. I don't really want to major in computer science. I really do want to major in economics. And it's from this movie that I decide to go on and study economics in college, and today I'm here as an economics professor at Utah State and the Huntsman School of Business. And you say, what kind of movie might have such power? Why is it that I'm sharing this story with you right now? Well, there's two reasons that I'm sharing this story with you right now. One is hopefully for some of you today, this conference over the next couple of weeks will be a canon event. Maybe there's something that you learn about yourself, about the world, something that causes you to say, it's that conference back then at Utah State that made me realize something new about my desires, about the world, whatever it is that you're looking for today. But the other reason why I thought about this is because the movie that I saw was WALL-E. And it is WALL-E that is responsible for me being here today. And it's an interesting thing to think about because the point of WALL-E is this unsustainable growth that has denuded the planet and forced humankind to flee to space in hopes that the little robot that could can help us return back to Earth one day when it's received its vitality again. And that is something that we might be worried about. That's not the clicker, that is. We have already heard today about the dangers facing Utah itself. As we've had large economic growth, we're starting to see environmental consequences, the Great Salt Lake being one of the most visible ones. We've seen this in the West. Arizona, since 1957, the population has grown 555%. Sounds like a Little Caesars deal, 555. Come and grow with us here in Arizona. Well, is the West even meant to sustain a population like this? Is it even possible for us to continue to grow the economy without damaging the very place that we call home? It's like there's a flashing yellow light warning us that we're headed for something in danger, and we need to slam on the brakes and make sure that we don't go out of control. This might have you ask the question, what does it mean to have sustainable development? Maybe that term has been thrown around. You might hear it in your classes, in the media. But what does sustainable development mean? This has been a question that's been on our minds for quite some time now. Back in 1983, the UN brought together the Brundtland Commission, also known as the World Commission on Environment and Development. In 1987, they published a report and they defined sustainable development as development that meets the needs of the current generation without compromising the needs of future generation, the ability of future generations to meet, satisfy their needs. Are we able to reach sustainable development? Have we ever had sustainable development? Well, often you hear about back in the past, we had sustainable development, and since the recent developments, we have seen unsustainable development. But let's go back and look at that past. This is infant mortality rates from 1800 to 2021. We are living in this era up here, but as we go back, you see infant mortality rates as high as 30%. Suppose there was a love story between two characters randomly named Travis and Taylor, who you are highly supportive of. It's a love story, but that baby's not saying anything. Because 1/3 of children die because of exposure to disease, undernutrition. So many issues in this world. And this is just for the data that we have consistently available. We go back to ancient societies, looking at ancient Egypt and the likes. We're calculating mortality rates for children before puberty as high as 50 to 70%. A world where you don't get to see your child grow and mature. This is the annual hours worked per worker. We hear all the time about, we have to work so much. We're over here, where within a year, we're working 1,500 to 2,000 hours a year. In the past, to support yourself, you had to work more than 3,000 hours a year, 50% more than the average person is working today. That's what it took to survive, to live in a world where 1/3 of your children die. Today, we get less hours worked, and we get to use that extra time to explore so many things. For example, we get to be educated. This is global literacy from 1820, global exposure to education, some form of basic education. Back in those times when we had high infant mortality rates and long working hours, very few people went to school. Over time, we've been able to get more and more people into school. Education gives us skills, that gives us opportunities, and lets us live more fulfilling lives. It's hard to capture other changes in graphs. But imagine going back to 1820 just if you were a woman. Imagine going back to 1820 if you were black. Imagine going back to 1820 if you were any other sort of marginalized community. The amazing opportunities that have been opened up in the last only 200 years, thanks to economic growth and development, have met so many needs. And that's something that I really want to make sure you walk out of this conference understanding. The world has never had sustainable development, because sustainable development has two halves. You have to meet the needs of the current generation without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. We have never been able to meet the needs of the current generation. If you are fine with living in a world where 1/3 of your kids die, are your needs being met? Absolutely not. It is amazing that economic growth has brought us to a point where we can meet your needs. But again, there's a yellow light flashing. We are just starting to meet the needs of the current generation. It's easy for us to look at this as we live in the United States and say that needs are being met, even though there are communities where they are not. Now go down to Haiti, where just last year, 4,000 people were murdered in the capital of Port-au-Prince because there's no government and gangs have taken over that country. Their needs are not being met right now. So we still have work to do to meet the needs of the current generation. But there is that yellow flashing light. Are we meeting the needs of the future generation? Are we compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs? That is a serious question, and is something that we should consider. And there are people that will want to deny that there are any problems going forward. And that is not what this is about. There certainly are things that we need to be worried about going forward. The question is, where should we be placing those concerns? This is the theme or the thesis of this conference. You know, you can tell that we must be in some sort of canon event because my text is glitching. But it says, modern life is literally built on resources such as oil, natural gas, wood products, minerals, and such, and continues to rely on them for its upward economic trajectory. But these resources have finite limits. These are things that we have stated in the thesis as if they are fact. And now the question is, should we accept the premises of this conference? Well, it's natural to believe that that's the premise, because here we have a relationship between real GDP in the United States and energy consumption, and they move in lockstep. These have been indexed so that way you can see the percentage increase where 1970, we're indexing off of that year, both directions. You don't get more GDP without more energy. It's like the economy is a machine being fueled by energy that spits out economic growth. Now, when I think about this graph, I think about another time back when I was your age. Again, it's freshman year, and I'm talking to a girl. I probably don't realize at the time that I'm trying to impress her, but the fact that this story still lives in my head rent-free tells me that I was. So, I, in elementary school, had a best friend who was Japanese. And he would get the Nintendo video games before they were released in the United States. And I remember playing Donkey Kong with him, and he's reading the Japanese to me. And I just think, this is so cool. And of course, this is the 90s. You're growing up, being exposed to One Piece, Dragon Ball, and Pokemon, right? Japan is becoming culturally dominant, and its technology is flooding the US. So when I go and register for my first semester of classes, I look at the course curriculum and I'm like, whoa, I could sign up for a Japanese class. There's no one stopping me from doing that. And so I start taking Japanese. I'm talking to this girl who's studying Chinese. And she looks at me when I've told her what I'm doing, and she's like, why would you study Japanese? And of course, you know, I've already revealed that I was very concerned about my future when I'm choosing the things that I study. And so, of course, I tell her, well, you know, with all the technological advancements, Japan is truly where the future of the economy is going. And she says, no. Like, the future of the global economy is clearly China. Like, if you are interested in learning a language that's going to be helpful as you go out into the business world, you should be studying Chinese. And I, you know, had to hunker down and defend myself and very solidly said, no, it's Japan that we should be betting on. And, you know, many years later, it's very easy for me to say that she was right and I was wrong. Most important indicator being, I have actually been to China and I have never been to Japan. But I was basing my projections on the future on my history growing up in the 90s, on what my experience was, without looking at what things had been, even after the 90s, which I should have seen. And so if you base your view on what it takes to grow the economy based on these old data, you're gonna miss this beautiful picture that emerges. We have seen a decoupling between economic growth and energy consumption. Our economy continues to grow without needing to consume more energy, without needing to consume more resources. Have we perfected this yet? No. But we are working on it. And we've seen that it does not take more and more resources, it does not take more oil and wood and all of these things to fuel the economy, as we assume in the thesis of this conference. So what happened? Some say, oh, you know, it's just that we're exporting this to other countries. No, actually, we can look at economic growth and we can look at our emissions coming out of here and we can adjust our emissions based on our consumption. Are we taking things from, are we having other countries produce our stuff? They consume the energy, and so it looks like we've reduced our energy consumption when in reality we haven't. No, we have reduced our energy consumption. In fact, in most of the developed countries, we continue to grow the economy while shrinking our consumption-adjusted energy use. And in fact, it's the poor countries that are growing without reducing their resource intensity. We want to escape that. We want to help them get out of that. That's going to require economic growth. So how has this happened? How can we keep the economy growing when without putting stuff in? It seems like you need to feed this machine. How is it still pumping things out? There's a couple of really important developments that have happened here. One I like to look at because it maps this so well is the relationship between crop yields and land planted. So this is corn, how much corn acreage there is, and how much corn yield there is. And it doesn't really matter which one is which because they move the same, just like that other graph. If you want more corn, you need to plant more land in corn. And that's historically how it had to be. We've started with slash and burn agriculture, where we go down, we cut down a bunch of trees, we burn them, and we let the ash of the trees become the organic material that enriches that soil. But we exhaust that soil over time, and so then we move to a new area. We slash down more trees, we burn them, we grow. We found out that there's fertilizer from cows or other livestock, right? Let the livestock graze, use the manure as fertilizer. This is fantastic. But it still doesn't, so that gives us more for that. But now if we want even more, we still have to move onto more land and put more fertilizer on it. Fertilizer becomes such a valuable resource for producing food that we start turning towards guano. We start looking at these islands covered in bird feces and saying, let's mine those. And we just hire professional pooper scoopers to go out there, take it from these islands, and we literally go to war with other countries to try and get control of these resources. Those are transported around the world, railroads bring them out, they allows us to expand west, but still, if we want more corn, we need more and more land. Same with the now synthetic fertilizer that we get from the Haber-Bosch process. Right? Nitrogen is in the air that we breathe, but it's hard to extract because it's inert. The Haber-Bosch process comes through, extracts the nitrogen, turns it into ammonia, and allows us to use it for fertilizer. We get more out of that land. But again, there becomes a limit where we say, if we want more, we need more land. Then comes Norman Borlaug, not just an American hero, a world hero. It's so sad to me that his story is undertold. Norman Borlaug is working for an organization that's trying to reduce rust, which is a fungus that comes into America and eats up all of the wheat plants. It starts in Mexico. And they have this idea, hey, if we can help Mexico fight this rust, then it won't blow up into our fields. And then we benefit, they benefit. This is a great thing. We should attack it at the source. Norman Borlaug goes down with the organization, and he sees poverty in Mexico. And he has the same argument that I have here. These people, even if we help this out, it's going to be very little. They need a massively improved economy if we're going to meet their needs. So he has this idea. I'm going to go out, and I'm going to try and figure out how to produce more wheat for the given land that we have. And you know, wheat has this nice evolutionary advantage, it's an evolutionary disadvantage because as wheat gets taller, you block out the other wheat, and so it's like evolutionary pressure competes to push it to be taller and taller. The problem is, if you get taller and if you get more wheat on the stalk, it becomes top heavy, it falls down, and it dies, and you actually can't produce the agriculture there. Norman Borlaug finds dwarf stalk wheat, hybridizes it with highly productive wheat, and is able to create the Green Revolution. His story is so amazing. He bought his own farm, and he didn't have enough money for the capital. It came with a plow, but he didn't have livestock. So he strapped the plow to his own back and had his neighbor guide it as he just walked up and down the field. The man's a hero. His dedication, and he has been able to change the world and feed the world. And it's because of those innovations that we've now decoupled agricultural production from land use. Our agriculture is so productive now that we're actually using less land than we were 100 years ago to produce 20 times as much food. Sorry, on that one, it's about 10 times as much food. That's amazing. Innovation And getting better and better at using our resources is a key tool for moving forward. That is how we've been able to decouple economic growth from energy consumption. We have been able to become more efficient. But that's not the only thing. How else are we increasing economic growth without consuming more and more resources? Well, let me tell you about when I moved out to Connecticut for graduate school. This is the house that we lived in. And we way underestimated how poor we were gonna be in graduate school. Graduate school, you know, is a PhD program. They tend to give you stipends. This stipend was designed for a single student. I had a wife, a kid, and by the end of our first year, we had a second kid. By the time I graduated, we had four kids. This stipend was not meant to support all of us. I like to describe how poor we were as bland oatmeal poor. We couldn't afford milk. We couldn't afford any like sugary seasonings or sugary cereal. We had oatmeal. We boiled it, and that's what we ate for breakfast. We were bland oatmeal poor. So poor were we that during the cold winters when I couldn't take my son right here out to the park, I would go to Walmart and just walk around the aisles, not to buy anything, just to get him out of the house and find the little sample toys that you could play with and let him just ride up and down the aisles, okay? We were poor, and as we were hoping to get more money, clearly that was gonna go towards buying more food, satisfying our needs. But thankfully, the great University of Utah, the great university here, Utah State University, has given me a great salary to support my family, though it could be higher. And with that salary, yes, we bought more food. But that is not how we spent all of our money. Now, I do Brazilian jiu-jitsu. This is me attempting to break someone's arm. I love this picture, and I really just put it up to flex, but that's all right. I spend my money not just on buying more and more food or more things that require resources. I have a jiu-jitsu coach. I spend a significant share of my money on things like that. My wife hires things like a personal trainer every once in a while, right? These are hiring people and services that don't require using much more resources. My jiu-jitsu instructor is eating every day and he's satisfied, but it doesn't require me burning coal to fuel him, though sometimes he's a machine and it feels like it. We buy more and more services. As you buy more accountants, more lawyers, as you buy personal trainers, and being here in this university, buying more education, you are purchasing more and more things that don't require more and more resources. You're getting more economic value. You're contributing to economic growth without having to contribute to depleting finite resources. That is the key to decoupling economic growth from energy consumption. We buy things that don't require more and more intense use of resources. That's how it's happened. How do we make sure it keeps happening? Well, there's a couple of things that we need to focus on given on what I just talked about. We need more innovation. Innovation has been a key driver to make sure that we use fewer resources and get more value out of them. There is still so much more that we need to do to innovate. We've had a green revolution in India, a green revolution in the West. We need a green revolution in Africa. Sub-Saharan Africa underproduces relative to the rest of the world. And that is because we have not focused on designing seeds that are adapted to the specific climate of the sub-Saharan African region. We need more work going on that. We need more work, more innovation in reducing disease environments. So that way we can meet people's needs. Again, malaria is a huge issue in sub-Saharan Africa. And it's only just recently that we've finally been able to crack a code at possible vaccinations against malaria. That was driven by the innovation that we saw in response to COVID-19. These innovations are what we need to go forward to get more of satisfying the current generation's needs without compromising future generations' abilities to meet their own needs. What else do we need? Capitalism. And you should have seen this one coming. We're economists. Of course we're gonna talk about markets whenever we get the chance. capitalism has been a major fuel for bringing these innovations to reality. That's one of the reasons why we don't see as much of an innovation driven towards places like sub-Saharan Africa, because the return on the investments in those areas is very low right now. People would rather focus on innovations here in the United States. And so we need to make sure that we're designing the systems that allow for people to go out and make these innovations in the place where they're most needed. And that's why we want to, most innovations are towards reducing resource intensity, because resources cost money. Scarce resources cost more money. Innovations that require us to use less of a scarce resource and can help us shift to a more abundant resource are going to be snatched up by businesses that say, hey, I want to reduce my costs so I can have higher profits. That provides the incentive. People respond to the incentives of prices are going up, my profits are going down, how do I get out of this situation? A lot of the world is mispriced. Like, the nice thing about capitalism is we say, let's put this out here and let the individuals find out how they want to allocate their resources. That's the distinguishing aspect of capitalism, is that resources are owned and allocated by non-governmental organizations. We run into trouble when we have the government organizing all of economic activity. We see this in communist China back in the 1950s and 60s. Mao had this great idea. Let's come up with the four pest campaign. Sparrows are eating our grain. If we didn't have sparrows eating our grain, we would have higher agricultural yields. Seems like a good idea at first, until you kill every sparrow in the country. Because yes, sparrows eat grain, but they also eat pests. And when you don't have the competitor to take them away, those pests come and decimate agriculture, and that contributes to many botched policies that lead to the Great Famine in China, that leads to millions and millions of people dying, their needs not being met. We're seeing this today in Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka last year said, 2 years ago, said, we are gonna switch to organic farming. So they banned fertilizer imports. Food scarcity went up, prices went up. It was a terrible situation, terrible policy when we just say we should have the government organize all of that economic activity. But I am no capitalism maximalist. I also believe that we need policy. We need sound policy from the government that not only promotes those things that will help us grow, but gets out of the way when there are things that we still need. We just talked about housing and the scarcity of housing here in Cache County. In Providence, just recently, there was a proposal. There was an approved development for denser housing. But you know what? The locals said, we don't want denser housing around here. And they voted to change the zoning. That is not, I mean, when we have house prices going at $500,000, there are plenty of people who would love to come in and develop this. But we have policy that's getting in the way from us being able to do this. We saw about the Great Salt Lake and the challenges we have with water here in Utah. It turns out that of the major US cities, Salt Lake has among the lowest per gallon water rates. It also consumes more water. Shocking. Our water is cheaper and we consume more. Our rates are 96 gallons per person per day, compared with 78 in Tucson, 77 in Los Angeles. I told you about my Little Caesars deal in Arizona earlier, 555, 555% population growth in Arizona since 1957. They have reduced their water use, total water use, by 3% at that same time. They use less water with over quintuple the population, because prices tell people, I shouldn't be using all of this water. I'm going to cut back on my water use. We need policies that put proper prices on these scarce resources. From this conference, I hope you're able to go out and look at more of these things. Here are some books that I recommend that would be very interesting to continue your understanding of how we're able to continue economic growth and development and reduce resource intensity. But that yellow light that's warning us here, that's telling us we need to slow down, that is not a yellow light telling us to slow down. That's a yellow light telling us that something is coming and you need to step on the gas and speed up to get through that intersection. Because if you don't, yes, we're gonna run into problems. But we need economic growth to make sure we can satisfy everybody's needs today and satisfy the needs of the future. I am not denying that we have issues that we need to resolve. There are plenty of people that want to be out there and deny these. But if you deny that there are solutions, you are on the same side as the people who deny that there are problems in the first place. And so I hope you come out of here today confident and excited to be part of those solutions, because you're who's going to come through and make those. Thank you.
I saw it coming, Craig. The story you have just heard, expertly delivered by Craig, nevertheless, is a pretty standard economic growth narrative coming to us from the economic community. We've built ourselves a wonderful house, and we've filled it with these amazing things. I view this narrative as a piece of a cost-benefit analysis. It's a piece that's a little heavy on the benefit side and perhaps a tad light on the cost side. So while mentioned, not emphasized in this narrative, is the fact that while we've built this wonderful house, in the process we've emptied the bank account, skyrocketed the credit card debt, and set the neighborhood on fire. To the extent that this narrative does acknowledge these costs, it tells us, as we just heard, the way to put out the fires is more of the same. More growth, more consumption, but green, you know, with a little more efficiency and maybe some cooler tech. The fires out there will take care of themselves so long as we keep the party in here raging. And the party in here is definitely raging. Well, for some of us anyway. The party out here is definitely raging. Now, the problem with this narrative is that, well, let me say that the narrative itself is very seductive, right? It's something we want to believe. That we can fix these problems, that everything's going to be okay, that the system can handle it. We just need a few tweaks to get us there. The problem with the narrative is that the data is telling us it isn't working, and the physics tells us that it can't. Now, hang on a second. You said, we just saw a whole bunch of data that tells us that the narrative is working. So I'll tell you something I tell my students often. Bear with me. We'll get there. What the data and the physics is telling us is a very different story. And that story is this: that economic growth on a global scale will end. And the probability that this is going to happen pretty soon is really pretty high. And this is a pretty scary narrative when we're told that everything good in our lives has come from growth. It's less scary, though, when we start to understand that lots of the things that are not so good in our lives has also come from economic growth. And it's in this piece of information that we have some pretty good news. Because if we can navigate this well, this transition away from a growth-based imperative economic paradigm will be a very, very good thing. So to help me tell this generally unpopular narrative, I would like to retell this economic story from a perspective of biophysical perspective. And I'm going to use a framework of a civilizational metabolism. Did you get that? So buckle up. Here we go. And the first thing we should probably do is remind ourselves what a metabolism is. And it's not too hard, right? Organisms take stuff from the environment, derive energy from that stuff, do stuff with that energy, like building stuff, including their own bodies, and then excrete waste back into the environment. We can summarize this whole process as a collection of flows of material and energy and waste between the organism and the environment. And we can extend this concept even further, beyond a single organism, to whole populations of organisms, to whole ecosystems, even to the entire biosphere. And for our purposes today, we'll extend it to our entire global human civilization, which has its own metabolism of extracting stuff from the environment, deriving energy from that stuff, doing stuff with that energy, and then excreting waste streams back into the environment. Now, before we apply this framework to the concept of economic growth, I want to focus on one particular resource in this set of flows, and it's this one. Because it turns out that energy is a particularly unique resource. In fact, the story begins and ends with energy. Energy is the coin of realm in everything we do. And so let's just take a little bit closer look at energy for just a few minutes. To see why it's so unique, we'll just start with what energy is. And it's right there in probably the most famous physics equation in the world, written down by the most famous and recognizable scientist who has ever lived. Energy is everything. Energy is stuff, and stuff is energy. And what makes energy special, then, in this case, is that energy is a unique resource as the master resource. It is the one resource that we use for which there is absolutely no substitute. There is nothing you can do without energy, no activity you can do without energy. And understanding why this is comes from understanding what energy does. And what energy does is make things move. And so energy is required for us to do everything. Any activity requires energy because any activity you can think of requires motion. Even thinking of those activities requires motions, the motions of charges moving around in your brain and your heart pumping the blood through your bodies. So energy is the master resource. We can't do anything without energy, including economic activity. So we need energy to do anything. Can we make energy? And I think most of you know the answer to this question. The answer is no. This is such a foundational law in physics that we've given it a special name. We call it the first law. And we all know that energy is not created or destroyed. We just move it around from place to place. So we can extract energy from the hydrocarbons in gasoline and make it move our car. And then when our car comes to a halt, that energy still isn't gone. It's just hiding in the microscopic motions of the atoms and molecules of the brakes. It's turned into thermal energy, but still motion. And still energy. Okay, so we need energy to do anything, and we can't make energy. How do we get energy? Well, we can harvest energy. And one place we can harvest energy is from moving things. The moving currents of wind and water, for example, moving turbines that can generate electricity for us to use. And we can also harvest energy from configurations of things. The configuration of a bow, which can set an arrow into motion, and the configuration of atoms arranged into molecules whose molecular bonds, when broken, release enormous amounts of energy. If it's a hydrocarbon in an engine, it moves the pistons and then moves the cranks and the wheels and the gears. So we can't make energy, but we can harvest it. Great. Can we just keep using that harvested energy over and over again? And the answer here is no. And I think most of you know this too. This is another foundational law of physics, but the name first law was taken. So we're going to call this one the second law. And the second law tells us that as we use energy to do useful stuff, as we move it around, some of it always leaks away. It turns into the microscopic motions of atoms and molecules, which we just saw. Thermal energy that we can no longer harvest, and we call this waste heat. And as we, for example, break the hydrocarbon bonds in gasoline to drive the pistons, to drive the wheels, to move the car, Some of that energy leaks away at every stage and turns into waste heat, to microscopic motions that manifest themselves in the car, the heat of the engine, the heat of the brakes, the heat of the tires. And the problem with this energy here is we can't gather it back up again, make hydrocarbons, and stick it back in the tank. We've lost its usefulness. And so another way to state the second law is that we can never use energy 100% efficiency. There is a limit. And in fact, the limit is quite a bit lower than 100%. There are no perpetual motion machines. We know this. And this means another way to state the second law is that without a constant flow of energy and materials, any kind of structure falls apart. To build any kind of structure takes energy. Whether that structure is a bicycle, or an automobile, or a pencil, a computer, or an organism itself. And I suspect anyone in this room who owns a piece of machinery, particularly a bicycle, a car, or a home, or is over the age of 60, knows that everything falls apart. And so this constant flow of energy and materials is constantly reassembling the things that we, the structures we build, including our own personal metabolisms that are constantly reassembling our bodies. Without that flow of energy, everything falls apart. Okay, so there's our exploration of energy. Let's review. Energy is the master resource, and this means that there is no substitute. Any kind of activity, including economic activity, requires us to use some energy. Secondly, we cannot use that energy fully efficiently. Some of it is always going to leak away, and this is not because we're not clever enough. Innovation will never take us past this particular limit. This is how the universe has decided we will operate, and no amount of innovation will overcome this particular barrier. Finally, all energy eventually becomes waste heat, which we can no longer use, trapped in the random microscopic motions of atoms and molecules, and this means that without a constant flow of energy and material, everything falls apart. Okay, so how does this apply to our civilizational metabolism? If we've established that a civilization has a metabolism, a flow of energy and materials in, a flow of wastes out, what would make a civilization sustainable? What constitutes that? Biophysically sustainable. And it's pretty much what you think. We have these flows of energy, material, and wastes, and the environment needs to be able to, in perpetuity, supply the flows that the civilization is extracting and absorb the wastes that the civilization is excreting. Now, if a civilization isn't sustainable, is it immediately going to just fall apart? And the answer is no. But what does happen when a civilization becomes unsustainable is we move into a region of what we would call overshoot. And in overshoot, we are now consuming the resources faster than they can be generated. And this has happened in many civilizations in history, who have extracted resources faster than the earth can replenish, turning them into trash and pollution faster than the earth can process. There are many examples in history of regional civilizations that overshot their resource base, leading to eventual ecological collapse and a collapse of the civilization itself. And this brings us to the notion that we've now talked about a little bit already today, decoupling. Is there a way around the overshoot such that we can decouple our civilizational metabolism from the flow of energy and materials? I think you know what I'm going to say. But it's a little more nuanced than you think, because we can certainly decouple our civilizational metabolism from specific resources. There is no physics preventing us, for example, from decoupling ourselves from whale oil, which we did about a century ago. And in this case, I'm talking about decoupling in an absolute sense, meaning that our civilizational metabolism is no longer dependent in any way on that resource, not simply dependent on less of it. Now, there are many resources that we can decouple ourselves from permanently. Another one is carbon. We are not doing that. In fact, we're not even close to doing that yet. I'll get there. But there is no physics preventing it. On the other hand, so we can decouple ourselves from specific resources. There is no problem with that. However, we cannot decouple ourselves from all material resources. There are some things that we will always need. Remember, everything is always falling apart. Everything we have built, that infrastructure, has an entropy fee. It's falling apart, and we need to constantly replenish it with some flow of material, which has ecological impact when we extract it from the environment. So we cannot decouple ourselves from all the stuff. And most importantly, there is one special resource that we cannot decouple ourselves from, and that is energy, the master resource. Remember, nothing happens without energy. Now, you saw some data a few minutes ago suggesting to us that we have, in fact, decoupled ourselves from energy. Let me first talk about this notion of efficiency. You said, hang on, it turns out we're using things so much more efficient. And it is no question that in becoming sustainable, efficiency is good. We definitely want to be able to use materials and energy more efficiently, and we have definitely been doing that. But efficiency is not decoupling. Decoupling means we no longer need that resource in our civilizational metabolism. And while we get more efficient with certain materials, if you're still doing things with them, you're still using them. And if you continue to grow your civilizational metabolism, then you need to use more of them. And in particular, remember the second law says, even though we can use energy more efficiently, there is a limit. And that limit is not because we're not clever enough. That limit is set by the universe. The laws of physics tell us we will never be able to use that energy 100% efficiently, and so we will never be able to decouple our growth from it. So let's talk then now about what we're here to talk about, our reigning paradigm of economic growth. So in our current model of economy, economists the worldwide and policymakers at pretty much every level, but certainly at the macro level, global level, seek global-wide economic growth at something like 2.5% to 3% every year. At 3% growth, we double the size of anything, annual growth, you double the size of anything in about 25 years, a little bit less. So right now, our plan on purpose is to double the size of our civilizational metabolism, aka our global economy, about every 25 years. And as you grow the economy, you grow material and, in particular, energy use. I'll get there. Okay, so that's the model that we're addressing. Is our current model, where we currently are, sustainable? Can the Earth continue to supply at the rates we're demanding the material and energy we're extracting and absorb the trash and pollution that we're excreting? There's been quite a lot of research on this. Quite a lot of data is telling us the answer is unequivocally no. Our civilizational metabolism right now is nowhere close to sustainable. One particular framework is called the Planetary Boundaries Framework, in which researchers identified 9 critical Earth system processes critical to the survival of civilization, and then looked at metrics for how much could we disrupt those processes before we become unsustainable. And these metrics processes are pretty much what you would think. They have to do with the climate system and the oceans and the atmosphere, with nutrients, with the biosphere itself, chemical pollution, with the ozone layer. And what we find is that out of 9 critical Earth system processes, if we disrupt any one of them beyond its sustainable limit, you can expect your civilization to be unsustainable. We have now disrupted 6. Well beyond their sustainable limit. And this framework, having been around for about 15 years, is showing that we are dramatically accelerating the rate of our impact on these critical Earth systems. 15 years ago, we were disrupting 3 of them unsustainably, then 4, and now finally 6. Another framework for examining the sustainability of our metabolism is called the global footprint analysis, where we look at how much land do we need to supply the materials we're extracting and absorb the wastes we're excreting. And what the researchers have found is that somewhere around the 1970s, we began to demand more from the environment than it could provide. Another way to put it is we required more than one Earth's worth of resources to continue our current civilizational metabolism, and where we are today is at 1.8. We are currently exceeding the Earth's ability to keep up with our demands by roughly a factor of 2. And you might ask, well, how can you extract more than the Earth can actually provide? And the answer is you can spend more than you make, as long as you have a bank account. But as you start to do that, you live off the capital rather than the income, to use an economic term, and you start to draw down the natural capital and build up an ecological debt, which we have been doing now for 50 years. And of course, there are many more frameworks to look at our sustainability. The ecologists tell us that over the last 50 years, we humans have wiped out 70% of the living creatures on the planet. And that rate is accelerating. They also tell us this over the next six to eight decades, we can expect to extinct up to 1 million species out of 10 million on the planet. Marine biologists tell us that if we go past 1.5 degrees of global warming to 2 degrees, which now seems all but certain, we will lose all of the Earth's coral reefs, priceless in their own right, but also the foundation of a biosphere system that is the primary source of protein for between 1 and 2 billion people. So when you put it all together, there are pretty clear indications that we have surpassed the Earth's sustainable ability to keep up, and we are now doing damage to the very systems that support us. So let's go back to that notion of decoupling. We heard a little earlier that we are, in fact, decoupling. But I'd like to say that, unfortunately, Craig made a couple of mistakes. We'll talk. He showed you a graph of the US energy versus GDP consumption. I'm going to show you a graph of the world's energy versus GDP consumption. Well, I don't have the GDP on there, but the GDP is going up. Our civilizational metabolism is increasing. Our economic activity is increasing. The scale of our economy is increasing. And does anybody see a drop? A decoupling of our global economy's use of energy. The problem with the civilizational metabolism is, in fact, a shell game. You can, in fact, export your production overseas. And what Craig showed us for energy was the US supposedly decoupling, but what he didn't show us was the consumption-based number. You only showed us the production number. And if you look at the consumption-based number, you find that actually we are increasing our energy consumption, although not very much, because we have, in fact, exported a great deal of our energy consumption overseas. We let other people manufacture the goods with their energy, and then we import them. So the problem is, in a fully globalized six-continent supply chain, there are problems with doing individual country comparisons. But when we look at the global human civilization, we see very strong coupling, as the physics tells us we must, between economic activity, civilizational metabolism, and our consumption of energy. There are, in fact, in this data, a few places where energy consumption went down. And we can learn from those locations, because those are locations where the economic growth also went away for a little while. So it turns out, if you want to decouple energy from economic growth, you need to get rid of the growth. And the same is true, actually, for materials. There's the energy plotted on another scale, again scaled to be comparable. And it's not just the energy there on the left, but we are also increasing, as the global economy increases, our total aggregate material extraction as well. When one goes up, the other goes up. When the economy goes up, energy goes up, and material goes up. We are not even close to decoupling. As the physics tells us, we cannot. Now, Craig made another mistake with energy. He did show us graphs of lines going down with production and consumption, and he referred to them as energy. But what he was showing you was carbon dioxide. And as I said, there is nothing in the physics that prevents us from decoupling from carbon dioxide. But those graphs did not show us energy. They showed us carbon dioxide. And they showed us that we are decoupling, not very fast, not even close to fast enough, but the physics is fine with that. We are not decoupling from energy. In fact, a study that came out 3 years ago by a group of researchers spent several years looking at 835 separate decoupling studies. And in those 835 decoupling studies, they found no evidence whatsoever for absolute decoupling of energy. And though they did find widespread evidence for efficiency gains in energy and in materials, as we know we can do. And that is good. Those are good things for us to pursue. Now, it's difficult for us to understand the scale of what's happening. And oftentimes we're told, oh, you environmental, latte-sipping, Prius-driving, fleece-wearing, you're all a bunch of chicken littles telling us the sky is always following. You're never acknowledging good news when it's there. It's hard to understand how this is happening. It's just, you guys are just always telling us the sky is falling and it never does. Well, two answers. Actually, the sky has fallen, as we've discussed many times, for many civilizations in the past. The difference now, though, is that these are not just regional economies separated from much other. This is a fully entangled global economy. And about the middle of the 20th century, as the result of very strong exponential economic growth, we went from being a small world on a big planet to being a big world on a small planet. And it happened very quickly because of the power of exponential growth. And what that means is our collective human civilizational metabolism went from being very small compared to the flows of the Earth system itself to being on the same scale as those flows, able to disrupt them and disrupt them in very large ways. So the story here is a story about where we are and where we're going to be. Where we are is deeply, deeply unsustainable. Now, by definition, anything that is unsustainable is going to go away. And so at some point in the future, where we're going to be, we will be sustainable. That is guaranteed. Right now, we sit down here deep in unsustainability, underwater, running out of oxygen. At some point in the future, we will be back in the atmosphere to a sustainable level. The question is, how are we going to get there, and what will that state look like? There are many sustainable states for human civilization, most biophysically sustainable. Most of them are not pleasant. We want the sustainable, just, and vibrant states, and that only happens with intent. What we need is a planned reduction in our civilizational metabolism. Yes, we need to use things more efficiently. Yes, we need to use things more wisely, but we also need to use less. The route that we are on, is going to take us to a level of roughly 4 planets worth of overconsumption in the next 3 to 4 decades, and 8 planets worth of overconsumption in the next 6 to 10 decades. Now, the physics of complex systems tells us that there is little chance we will get anywhere near that level of overshoot. If we do not plan our increase in sustainability, the reconnection of our economy to its ecological limits, if we do not plan it, that dashed line there that's nice and gentle, and get ready for what's coming, we simply continue to drive ourselves deeper and deeper into unsustainability. And when the correction finally comes, rather than being planned and organized, it becomes more chaotic and more disruptive. So our choice is, which one of these do we want to take? We all want a vibrant society, and the good news is there are frameworks that can take us to a sustainable level of metabolism. We are not choosing to follow those frameworks at the moment. That's the path we want. On this question of innovation, to conclude, I fully agree with Craig and the standard line from economics, which is that, yes, innovation drives amazing things for humans. Again, the question is knowing where we are, knowing where we want to be, and then identifying a path between the two. It's like standing at the base of a mountain that's never been climbed and trying to figure out how you're going to get to the top. And there are many paths leading out of base camp, and you need to start making choices. You need to narrow down that solution space. And so what we do need to do with our innovation is narrow down the solution space. And the very hardest boundary on that solution space is hard physics. If your path to the top of this particular mountain requires you to build warp drives or time machines or anti-gravity boots or perpetual motion machines, that path is not going to take you to where you want to go. We need to apply our innovation to the paths that actually are possible, the ones that actually exist in the solution space. The impossible paths are bounded by hard physics. The possible paths are probably still bounded by all kinds of challenges, social, cultural, political, economic. And even though those challenges may be very difficult, they're not impossible. And difficult is much better than impossible. So we need to apply our innovation not to trying to take us along a path that physics will not allow us to take, and rather apply our innovation to those paths that are actually possible. So the story I've just told you has been a story of a biophysical system that has grown for thousands of years and economic system from infancy through the adolescence that we've been experiencing for the last century or so, and now needs to grow up. We need to move to a place of maturity, as do all living systems, where you no longer need to grow in order to thrive. Ending economic growth by no means means ending economic development or human development. It means setting your goal not as economic growth, but human well-being. Growth will end. The data is telling this, screaming us this message at the top of its lungs. That is guaranteed. We will be sustainable at some point. We just don't want the unpleasant sustainable states because we crashed our way to them. That's chapter one of the story. Chapter two is a post-growth scenario, starting to apply our minds to actually solving the problem of how do we create a society that is vibrant, that whose economy doesn't need to grow in order to thrive. Thank you. More to come.
Hi, everyone. My name is Anna McIntyre. I am the managing director of the Janet Quinney Lawson Institute of Land, Water, and Air here at Utah State University. And I have the privilege of leading a very, very fast panel of some of our speakers today. While we are getting sorted and getting running, can I use you, Patrick? Okay, so building off of Dr. Johnson's introduction about the framework that we're using and getting uncomfortable and our anchoring biases, the panel would like to hear from the audience. Maybe we can put the house lights up a bit so we can see a few of you who are in there. And hey, we've got Craig and Rob sitting right next to each other. Good job. So what I would like you to pretend is that you're answering a Qualtrics survey on a slider scale of your level of agreement. We have two fairly different perspectives on growth and sustainability from Craig and Rob, which we really appreciate their bravery and preparation for putting those together. But I'd like you to pretend that full agreement with Craig is on this side of the stage. Full agreement with Rob is on the other side of the stage. And we've got Patrick, who is our slider scale. I would, as Patrick walks across the stage from Team Craig to Team Rob, I would like you to raise your hand when he's at the spot generally that you occupy with your agreement. And I feel like it's fair for the panel to do that as well. It'll be easy for Craig, it'll be easy for Rob. So growth must continue. Yes, growth must continue, growth will end. Ready, walk. Okay, there you go. We could, we're in such a hurry though, it would be great. Okay. Very interesting. Thank you for your participation. I hope that that was really helpful. Also, thank you to Frank and Patrick for facilitating this. I think Brian did text me during this and said, this is way more interesting than I thought it was going to be. It was a lot of fun. So we appreciate this, and we thank you for your efforts in putting it on. I would like to start. We've got those who presented that we can ask additional questions of, and we've got some new faces as well. All of you have received a card. This is Betsy Brunner. She is also helping with the dialogues, and if you have one to give to her, she will take it. She will review them. She will choose a precious few that we're going to answer in the next 10 minutes. But this is just a sampler. This is a taste test of additional conversations. We're going to have a 50-minute panel with many of the same faces a week from today. So these questions are those that Betsy and I are going to be sorting through to develop the content as what is going to be our full panel next week. But where I would like to start is with our new faces here. We have Caitlin and Ben, and I'd like you to start by just introducing yourselves because we haven't had the chance to do that, and just give us your quick hot take on what your responses are to the presentations that you've seen today.
Yeah, thank you. I'm Caitlin McLennan. I'm the Director of Sustainability here at Utah State University. Quick hot take from me, I live in the in-between space. I spend a lot of my time trying to get people to make decisions with the environment and people at the top of their minds over capitalism. And so it's interesting to me to see these global frameworks, right, put up in front of the screen for quite a long time, and I'm thinking through my head, and I think about global emission scenarios, and I think about a fair share contribution from the United States, right? What do we need to do here in this room and at this organization to ensure that we don't overshoot those planetary boundaries and ensure that people in developing countries are taken care of and their needs are met? And I think it's somewhere in the middle. Quick.
I'm Ben Blau. I'm the department head of economics and finance, and I just have to say this was awesome. Was this awesome? I think we should give the presenters another hand. My hot take has very little to do with economic growth, that side or that side, but the benefit of coming together and having a discussion. And the fact that Rob and Craig can sit next to each other. I think this is a great opportunity. I was interested. I've learned a lot in Rob's presentation. Some of the things that Craig have said are being said in economic circles around the world, around the country for sure. So I'm just pleased that we can come together and have this discussion. I think it's super important.
Thank you. Okay, I would like to, while we have this particular group on here, we have Rob and Craig, and we have two commissioners who have a lot of influence on the way that Utah grows. Rob and Craig, you've got your magic wand, and you can make Brian and David do one thing that you want them to do. Yeah. What is it?
Oh, go for you first?
Go ahead. I can't do like one thing each or just one thing. Okay, price water according to what it should be in the market and allow more housing, denser housing, because I mean, I love the video actually. It's been popping up on my Facebook too, so you guys are targeting those correctly.
Wow, such a great question. I think I'm not as creative. I think I'm not quite as down-to-earth practical as that. I think what I would like is for us as a society, and certainly as a citizen of Cache Valley, as a citizen of Utah, I want our practitioners, that would be our business people in particular, and particularly in the business community, to start thinking about how it is they would start to orient their business if what I just said was in fact true. Like if we can expect a post-growth scenario coming in the next several decades, by design or by disaster, we'd rather have it by design. I think I'd rather, as those disruptions start to amplify, I'd like to have citizens, but particularly businesses, our provisioning systems, thinking ahead right now, like what am I going to do if this actually happened, if we started transitioning. And I'm hoping that people like Brian and David can start to plant those seeds, at least in the planning committees that they're in.
Brian and David, do you have any responses to that? Or the types of things that you are balancing as you are making those decisions in response to what you've heard today?
Well, I want to tell them what to do, since they told us what to do.
Yeah, go for it.
Well, because that's what I was thinking. I was thinking, well, if I had that question, what would I ask the people at the university level to do? And I think I would say two things: collaboration and innovation. And innovation is absolutely something that you are fantastic at. Collaboration, I feel like we've been a little weaker than we could be or should be, especially in recent years with polarization. And I love what Governor Cox is doing right now. Governor Cox has this campaign called Disagree Better. Has anybody heard of that? You should look it up. He's trying to get people to learn how to talk to each other when they have different opinions and how to get along with each other and still be friends even. And I think that's the only way that we're going to be able to innovate, is if we get people together who have different opinions, like we're doing today. This is awesome with these dialogues. We have to get people together who have different opinions and have them sit down and talk to each other. And the other thing we need to do is we need to allow our economy and the capitalist system that Craig talked about to have the freedom to innovate. And how many people have an iPhone? Let's see. I should probably just say who doesn't have an iPhone, right? Almost everybody has an iPhone. So maybe I'll tie this all together: government and innovation and sustainability. So the fourth governor of Utah, his name was Simon Bamberger, and he was a German immigrant. He was Jewish. He was the first non-Mormon governor of Utah. He was the first Democrat governor of Utah, and he was an entrepreneur. And he started this really cool place called Lake Park down in Farmington. You've probably been there. It's called Lagoon now. So Lagoon was started by this guy. He was a serial entrepreneur. He had started a garment factory with his brother, and he had hotels, and then eventually got into mining and rail. And so he built Lagoon halfway along his rail line between Salt Lake and Ogden. Later on, there was a guy called Nolan Bushnell who worked there in the arcade. And the arcade then was not what we think of now with video games. If you think of an arcade, it was like throw a ball at the bottles and knock them down. And he worked there, and he went on to actually create what we do think of as arcades. He founded a company called Atari. And he had a couple of employees who worked for him. They were both named Steve. You might have heard of them before, Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak. They split off, started their own company, Apple. We have iPhones now. We have smartphones. We have so much innovation. And I love the connections, if you can trace them back. I used to watch this show when I was a kid called Connections on PBS. It was hosted by Burke. And we have so many connections, and if we allow them to evolve, if we allow the innovation, we can have incredible things come to pass in our economy, in our world. And I think that's the solution to everything we're talking about today. So we have to collaborate, we have to work together, we have to talk together, and then we have to allow the freedom for innovation to happen.
You good? I'll go to that, or I can go to the next one. Brian, this is for you.
I'll just go really fast and say this. Listen, I think that the important point is here, I think we're going to have to listen to everyone on these issues because I think it's going to take all of us to work together. And in truth, I'll tell you straight up, as someone who's tasked with kind of saving things like the Great Salt Lake, it's not super straightforward. There's not like one solution that's going to fit all. Pricing would actually help. It would help. But it's not the only thing that'll get us there. And so having a more robust conversation, I think it really helps. And what I would also advocate you all is being part of the system.
Great, thank you. We have time for one question from the audience. You were seeing all of these being submitted and voted on. We will be going through these. These are going to be the topics that we're going to be talking about next week at our panel. But for anyone, we've got 2.5 minutes, and then I'll have one more quick fire to answer. How can we as individuals aid in efforts to balance economic growth and sustainability?
No. I don't know if it's an individual's problem. That might be a controversial answer, but I think it's the business of our governments, institutions, and organizations to take responsibility for the emissions that are associated with their resource consumption. An individual would have to live for, oh gosh, can I think of the number off my head? I think it's 58 million years to emit what Shell did in 2022 alone. Just let that sit for a second. And that's just talking about CO2, right? Carbon dioxide equivalent. I'm not even talking about water or soil or other planetary boundaries. But if you think about it at an individual level, organizing, voting, talking to people, I tell people to talk about their feelings about climate all the time because that's where we can find common ground. Yeah, go to school to be me.
Thank you. Okay, last quick fire question. We'll start with David. One word answer. You can go as much as 5 if you have to. And then Patrick is going to close us out. When we were talking about the issues of growth and sustainability, what feelings do you have?
Hope.
Ooh. Where does it go? To me?
All the way down the line.
Resilience.
Yeah, I'll echo both of those. Hope and resilience.
That was more than 5 words, just saying. I'm going to say work. Work.
Exhilaration.
Resolve.
Love those. Thank you very much. Let's thank our panelists for their participation.
So we have heard a lot today in these 2.5 hours. And thanks to everyone for being on time and making sure that we finish this up on time. We've got a lot to think about, and that's built into the way we've set this up. We've got a week to be thinking through some of these disconnects that we've heard. Is energy use going up or is it going down? There's a truth there, and we need to get to the heart of it. Have we decoupled or have we not? There's a lot more to be discussed there. So the whole point of this is to have some time to really think through these issues deeply and to have some more conversations. And I'm thrilled that you all were here today. We are going to take all of these questions that you submitted online and through the cards, and we'll be percolating through them over this next week. We'll have a lot more conversations next week. We're going to pick 5 of the people who submitted questions one way or the other, and we'll send you some prizes. So thanks so much for being here, and look forward to seeing you again next week. I do want to also just thank our production crew, Ricardo and Eddie and all you guys. You've done awesome. Thank you so much.